and welcome to Backstage with the Phil. I'm so glad you decided to join us. We were blessed with some dry weather for this afternoon, so let's embrace it as long as we can. But I must say that in spite of this rain that we've been having and this weather, we were able to have 8 really fantastic children concerts. For Nampa, for here in Boise, and just unfortunately a couple of schools couldn't make it, but all in all, we had a great turnout, and to watch students hear Stravinsky, Firebird for the first time, and hear about the story is just something else. So, the Philharmonic has had a busy couple of weeks, but the weather doesn't stop us, and doesn't stop great music. This program, Viennese Masters, it features 3 composers that indeed epitomize the Viennese high classical and romantic style. Of course, we begin with Mozart's noble overture to his final opera, The Magic Flute, and we continue on with Schubert's Symphony No. 5, written when the composer was just a mere 19 years old. Now, Schubert had an excruciatingly short life of only 31 years. So 19 is not so young for Schubert. But indeed, this is an incredibly youthful, charming, and brilliant work. I must say that in this year that he composed his 5th symphony, he also managed to compose his 4th symphony, and about 200 odd other works. In his lifetime, over 1,000 works altogether. Imagine that, it's absolutely tremendous. So that pairing of 2 prodigious composers, Mozart and Schubert, I thought was so important. And in this symphony, you do see the fingerprints of Mozart. At this time, Schubert was so much more fascinated with that Viennese tradition of Mozart, more so than what Beethoven was doing. Beethoven at this point had already composed 8 of his 9 symphonies, but Schubert was much more interested in what Mozart had done with his works. So you will hear lots of Mozart in the symphony, or influences thereof. In particular, his Symphony No. 40 in G minor. You'll hear it most notably in the Minuetto, which is fierce and on fire. You'll also hear lots of Haydn. There's no shortage, as I said last time with the Prokofiev, there's no shortage of Haydn, Haydn's sense of humor. And in the finale in particular of the Schubert, you will indeed hear a great sense of humor with sudden stops, and then new themes that begin in a key that's so far away from what you would expect with your ears that they just kind of, you know, make you jump and make you awake and make you smile with delight. And Schubert was actually the only native son of Vienna. So when you look at these 3 composers, Schubert was actually born in Vienna, or just outside of. Other composers, of course, would flock to Vienna. So Mozart from Salzburg and Beethoven from Germany. But it's where composers would come, because Vienna in the 18th century and 19th century was the musical hub. It's where all the tastemakers were. It's where you went as a young composer to prove your worth. And so it's interesting that of these 3 composers, Schubert was the one that was actually born in Vienna. And they are indeed proud of that. But our grand finale of this weekend is Beethoven's final piano concerto. It's Piano Concerto No. 5, The Emperor. And joining us today is our very special guest artist for the Emperor Concerto, Natasha Paremski. So I'd like to bring her up here to talk a little bit more about herself and talk a little bit more about the work. So please join me in welcoming Natasha Paremski.
Thanks, Eric. Really great to be here. Hi, everyone. Thanks for coming out. I hope I'm more interesting than, like, daytime television. That's what I would be doing. Anyhow, I'm here to play Beethoven's Emperor Concerto, and it was nicknamed the Emperor Concerto because he originally wrote it to honor Napoleon. At first, Beethoven was actually a big, big fan of Napoleon until he invaded his country. And that was really awkward because he invaded his country as he was writing this piece to dedicate to Napoleon, so he had to rewrite the title, because he had actually dedicated it to him, but then he scratched all that out, and specifically for the second movement, he wrote, and the second movement is rather, it's really like a meditation. He wrote, "May Vienna give Napoleon his due." So it is very regal and very royal and, you know, very exciting. And at the time, it certainly pushed the envelope in terms of virtuosity. Of course, now we had all the Rachmaninoff concertos come through and the Prokofiev concertos come through. And it's certainly not as physically and virtuosically challenging, but it is an extremely beautiful piece, and there are a lot of features for the orchestra, which is cool, because there are a lot of wind solos and horn solos, and it's really like a big old symphony. And I actually, there are a lot of times where I really just support what the orchestra is doing, so it's just really fun to play, and the Boise Symphony sounds so, so great, and under the direction of your fabulous new maestro, who's just a total joy to work with. He's so easygoing. I'm not. No, I think we're getting along really well. I mean, I really love working with you.
We are.
Anyway, so I was told I'm supposed to talk about myself, which I really hate doing. So I'll give you all the good stuff because I have the mic. and then you can hear all the other, my dark side, you can hear about it from all my friends and stuff. So I'll give you their phone numbers. I was born in Moscow in 1987, so I'm basically Schubert's age, because I turned 32 in May, so I'm Schubert's age when he died. So that's how I'm connected to this program. It's sinister. How am I doing? Day-day television. my parents, after Perestroika, they decided to emigrate to the United States, which was kind of an interesting and rather sad story, because my father was, there was sort of an assassination attempt in regards with this whole apartment tradition that happened in Russia. Like, if you had worked for the government for X amount of years, you were in line to get a bigger apartment from the state. And someone wanted to cut in line, and because after Perestroika, it became just such a free-for-all economically, someone tried to kill him. And that was basically the reason that my mom was finally able to convince him to move the family over to the United States, where there were a lot of opportunities for scientists like him. I should have started with the fact that he worked in nuclear science and computers. So he integrated like missile systems and nuclear missile systems and things like that. So before the incident, he really didn't want to go at all. And he said, "No, I'm a patriot, I love Russia, I wanna stay here. Like, we gotta grit through all this, it'll get better." And my mom's like, it's not gonna get better. Like, drugs everywhere, crime, this is not good. And it's, the drugs and crime happened literally the minute the wall fell. So she just, I remember walking with my mom, and she, it was me and my brother on either side, and we would hold her arms like this, and she had pepper spray in both her hands, because it just became so incredibly unsafe. So my dad gets attacked, he falls into a coma, they give him a 50-50% chance of survival. And this job recruiter from California, who keeps trying to convince him to come over, calls my mom and says, "Yeah, so has Mikhail thought more about, maybe coming to California?" She said, "Oh yes, I have great news. Yes, Mikhail and I talked, and he is ready to do this. We're gonna do this, it's happening." "Oh, great news, can I see him?" "Oh, he's out of the country on a business trip. But I have power of attorney." So if you'd like to give me those papers, you know, I can sign them like today. My dad's like, we don't know if he's gonna wake up. So a month later, he wakes up. My mom's like, hi, sweetie. So going to America. My mom's 17 years younger than my dad, and she was basically my age when she just said to this 47-year-old man, like, so I made the decision for us because my children need a father. So that is how we ended up in America when I was, he came first and he found a job, and I was 8 when I immigrated. My brother was 6. So that's how we made it here, and it was not for my music. My mom was not a stage mom. I had already started playing the piano in Russia, but it wasn't anything like, I was not the focus of the family. And it was made very clear to me from the very beginning when we got to America that because lessons were no longer free as they were in Russia, because the state pays for music education in Russia, they don't have the money for piano or lessons. So it would, you know, and at first I thought, oh, it's fine. You know, it's like new country, new language, and I don't want to practice. And, you know, it's funny, I still don't want to practice. it didn't sink in right away, but after about 8 months, I really started feeling this just gaping hole. And my mom got tickets to see Evgeny Kisin, whom I had just totally obsessed over as a pianist. And she got tickets to see him at Davies Symphony Hall in San Francisco. And I keeled over with excitement. So off we go to see my idol live. And I just had to really crying the whole time because I just thought, this is so exciting, and I could feel the excitement in the audience, and then his like 25 encores, and I was just bawling. I turned around to my mom and I said, I want to do that. And I mean, I don't want to just like play the piano. I want to be a soloist. I want to play at Davies. I want to do that. And can I do that? And she says, we're gonna have to make a lot of sacrifices, so you better be really serious about this. And the next day I said, I'm even more serious about it than I was last night. It's just getting worse now. So they pulled it together, and they did make a lot of sacrifices for me to do what I do now. And it was in 2003, so it was about, so let's say I was about 9 when that happened, so I was 16. So 7 years later, I played the Tchaikovsky First Piano Concerto with the San Francisco Symphony at Davies Symphony Hall.
Wow.
So, a lot of practicing. Thanks. And then, you know, one thing led to another, and I am so lucky to say that this is how I pay my bills. So I feel very blessed and very honored to stand here in front of you today and be able to play with the Boise Philharmonic and, you know, play these beautiful concertos. That's it. Does anyone have questions or concerns? Are we not doing questions now?
John, do you have any continuing contacts back in Russia?
Well, my brother lives there.
Well,
yeah, you won't believe who he works for, Boeing. Moscow, yeah, Boeing Moscow, it's like huge over there, yeah.
Have you played at any venues in Russia?
Yes, I played at the Tchaikovsky Hall. I recorded in Russia. I played at the Gnesin Academy. Yes?
How did you have zero accent? Do you speak Russian with an American accent, or do you try to speak
Russian? Well, you know, the cutoff age for accents is like 12 to 14, right around like teenagehood. So if you get in before that, it's like you're just more pliable, I guess. Like, you have a more flexible tongue, I don't know.
Where do you live now?
New York.
Oh.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, my mom still lives in California. She works for NASA. We're underachievers. Anybody else? No? All right, yeah.
What happened to your dad?
Oh, my father passed away from cancer 7 years ago.
Oh.
Yeah. But he ended up working for Cisco Systems and then Technicolor, and he did very well for himself in America, for sure.
You paint a pretty dark picture of Russia when you left. Your brother is over there. Has it gotten better?
Oh, it's pretty amazing there now, actually. Yeah, and especially if you consider, you know, when we left, it was so abysmal, and it's really remarkable how it's turned around. I mean, he loves living there. Moscow is an insanely modern city. It is, the infrastructure is really incredible. It's there are a lot of things for young people to do, a lot of like a fun night scene, and extremely safe. I mean, my brother, you know, he'll tell you, like, you could be out till 4 a.m, be fine. So it's no different from New York, except maybe better airports.
You kept up on your Russian.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, I really have to credit my parents for that, because I think they sacrificed their English so that my brother and I could really retain our Russian, because, you know, that's the first thing to go is your native language if at home you don't speak it. So my parents, we'd come home, we're so excited to learn English because it's something new, and we're like learning new words and, you know, new sentences every day. You're just, it's so easy to absorb things when you're that little. And, you know, we're speaking to each other in English to, you know, keep improving. And they're like, mm-mm. They just wouldn't answer us if we were talking to them in English. They would absolutely, they were just like blank stare. And so they forced us to speak in Russian. And we watched Russian movies in the evenings. And, you know, we'd do like one Russian movie and one English movie. And my mom would put Russian literature in front of me, and I read all the, you know, I read all the classics in Russian, so I can read, write, and speak. So I'm very grateful to them for that. Yeah.
Any other languages?
Oh, you know, like the most embarrassing amount of French and a little bit of Spanish. No.
Anybody else? Thank you, Natasha.
Thank you.
Schubert and Mozart to the program notes that are in the book, and I'm going to talk about Beethoven. I'm absolutely intoxicated with this character. The more I find out about him and the more I listen to his music, the more I'm just utterly amazed at what he was able to accomplish. You know, 5 of his 9 symphonies are considered to be the best symphonies that were ever written. 3, 5, 6, 7, and 9. And 2 and 8 are some of my favorites also. There isn't an orchestra or a music director anywhere who doesn't routinely program Beethoven's works, including his sparkling violin concerto and his fabulous piano concertos, including 4 and 5, which are 2 of the best ever written, which 5th we're gonna hear tonight, which is the Emperor. Why? Because audiences the world over flock to experience a Beethoven evening. And I don't say just listen to, I say experience a Beethoven evening, because that's what you come away with, I think, when you listen to his great pieces. These are experiences. He charms us with his beautiful melodies. He moves us with his incredible rhythms, and he captivates us with what I think that comes through is his humanity, his absolute humanity as a composer. Now, he wrote these works over 200 years ago. 200 years ago, at a different time, place, social, culture, just think. Yet they continue to inspire and enthrall us as much as they did back then and throughout history. He's never lost his popularity with people. So when I see something like this, I'm kind of an inquiring idiot. I say, well, why? What is it about Beethoven's music that causes it to have this timeless, universal appeal that somehow seems to speak to everybody? What is it that he has that so many, somebody who was writing a PhD thesis, probably with way too much time on his hands, reports that there were over 18,000 symphonies written by Beethoven's time. 18,000.
Most of those have disappeared into the dust, but yet Beethoven, 3, 5, 6, 7, 9, I mean, they're all incredible. What's the secret? What was it that he had that enables him to be able to do this? Well, there are four main ingredients that I'd like to talk about this afternoon. And of course, there are many others. You could spend a week analyzing any one of Beethoven's pieces. But there are four main components that I'd like to talk about. The first one is his conception, his idea of the role of music in the world, in society and in a culture, the role of music. And his radical idea of the role of a composer and a soloist performer. His idea of that, of these were very, very different. And this attitude, which is what I call it, this attitude that he had towards who he was, what he was doing, what this was all about, comes through in absolutely every one of his compositions written after 1802. Now, why do I pick 1802? We know that Beethoven was losing his hearing, and he wasn't going stone deaf, as many of you know. We've talked about this a lot, but his hearing was being replaced by tinnitus or tinnitus. In other words, he heard growling noises, squealing noises, all kinds of terrible noises in his ears. And remember, just think for a second, if you had Beethoven's talent, and this was your calling, and all of a sudden you're losing your hearing and it's being replaced by this cacophony, this awful stuff. Well, we know that this really got to Beethoven shortly after the turn of the century. He'd gone to every doctor in the world. These are some of the crazy hearing aids that he was using, putting these things on his head back then. We know what he was going through because he wrote a document that we now call the Heiligenstadt Testament. They found it many, many years later in a drawer, and the testament lays out the horrible things that losing his hearing was doing to him. He was unable to relate to humanity. He couldn't have a conversation with you because he really couldn't hear you. And it drove him to the brink, as he says in the Heiligenstadt Testament, of suicide. And he seriously considered it, taking his own life because he was so undone by what was happening to him. But instead of succumbing to that dark instinct, he dropped back and he said, no, I have something to offer to the world. And I'm not giving up until I've given everything that I have in terms of my art to humanity. So this was a guy, instead of seeing the glass half full and shrinking, at that point he saw the glass half full and he was going to fill it up. So that was the attitude that he stormed out of this Heiligenstadt Testament with after 1802, writing then his third symphony, which changed the trajectory of the world in terms of the way symphonies are. By the way, Eric has programmed the third symphony for next season. It's going to open the year. This is a fantastic symphony also. So he came out of there with this, what I call this attitude. And he became a steely, tough guy in terms of his fate. And you can see that this is the way he's always pictured in his pictures, but that masks another element of his music that gets ignored a lot of times. Eric touched on it. This guy has more humor in his music than you can shake a stick at. He's constantly playing musical tricks on everybody, but we tend not to hear those because we think of this guy storming at the sea, you know, the heavens, battling his fates, but just living with this incredible sense of humor. So that's the first thing. It's his attitude towards everything. Second ingredient is his incredible creativity. This guy was beyond creative. He could take the simplest melodic idea, rhythmic idea, thematic idea, and turn it into this incredible soundscape. He was a master at improvisation. Now, at that time in Vienna, the measure of how good you were as a pianist was how well you could improvise. And in the salons that were put on by the aristocrats and the royals, they frequently had what they called piano duels. They would bring in two of these hotshot virtuosos, they'd sit them down at pianos, and they would throw a musical idea at them, and they'd say, okay, what do you got? And Beethoven was just phenomenal at these duels. He crushed everybody. He was so good. He was the absolute master of his craft. He studied, by the way, with Haydn. So, you know, Haydn is sort of the fountain, as Eric pointed out, of a lot of this stuff, but he was a Haydn student. But this creativity, this ability to improvise, and now that I know that about him, I hear that all over every one of his pieces. You know, Rachmaninoff takes these enormous melodies, which are wonderful, and Tchaikovsky, but Beethoven takes these little atomic ideas, and the next thing you know, he's turned it into this incredible moment. The third ingredient that comes through, and this is what I mean when I talk about humanity, is his amazing storytelling ability. Each one of his pieces is a story. It has a plot. It's dramatic. And even though you're kind of not aware of it the way you are when you read a novel or a book, it comes through. It's just an amazing ride that he's able to give us. And frequently, more often than not, he starts in terrible adversity, and he ends up in this triumph. I mean, this is the guy who simply, you know, to be or not to be, it will be, which is, by the way, the last thing he wrote on one of his string quartets. Must it be? It must be. He was very, very familiar with Shakespeare and Hamlet. So his life comes through like crazy. The fourth ingredient is his masterly use of rhythm. I mean, sometimes his use of rhythm is so powerful and so compelling, and it just grabs you and takes you with the music, that it overpowers everything else. So those four things, his conception, his creativity, his storytelling ability, and his remarkable use of rhythm. So let me begin by discussing his revolutionary concept of the purpose of music, the role of the composer and the soloist in society. Now, the Viennese classical style that he inherited from Haydn was designed primarily to entertain its patrons, meaning the aristocrats and the royals, people with a lot of money. This was really written as entertainment. I'm not putting it down at all because it's marvelous entertainment, but that's what it was written for. Its benign purpose was to entertain these people with a whole lot of dough. Haydn, for example, worked for the same prince for 28 years in a palace at Esterhazy, and he was regarded as help. He ate in the kitchen with the butler, the chauffeur, the garden, and the maids. Think Downton Abbey, you know, the kitchen? That's where Haydn ate. And that was the role of the composer and the performer at that time. Pretty remarkable. Let me just quote a renowned English music historian, George Burney, who described the music of the 18th century as, listen to this, the music of the late 18th century, an innocent luxury, unnecessary indeed to our existence, but a great improvement and gratification to the sense of hearing. It doesn't sound all that exciting, does it? Mozart himself wrote to his father and said, quote, passions, violent or not, must never be expressed to the point of disgust, and music must never offend the ear, but must always be pleasing. So this gives you a sense of where that crowd was coming from in writing this music. Now, accordingly, the high Viennese classical style of Haydn and later on Mozart was notable for its elegance, its grace, its balance, its good taste, its symmetry. And again, I'm not putting it down. These are just the elements that you hear in this music. Its transparency, its logic, it's all right there. It was art for art's sake, very objective. Not at all a medium for the composer to express himself or herself, not at all. It was art for art's sake. Haydn and Mozart and their contemporaries wrote in this measured style primarily for one reason, which I've already alluded to. It's another expression of the golden rule. He who has the gold rules, and the aristocrats had it, and that's what they wanted to hear. I mean, Mozart was criticized for writing too many notes, my dear Mozart, too many notes. It's just amazing to look back and to read this stuff. Now, Beethoven started out with these musical values as a young man who went to Vienna studying with Haydn, and he absolutely changed every one of them forever. When you study this, you'll see that they say, well, he started as a classicist in the Viennese style, but he really opened the door to the 19th century romanticism that followed, where music became a completely different idea. He used all the models and the forms that he had inherited from Haydn, like sonata, allegro form, theme and variations, minuet and trio, rondo. He inherited all those, but he completely turned them around. Before, form really controlled the content. And to Beethoven, the form had to be second to the content. So they simply had to serve what he had to say, what he wanted to say. He as a composer, he was the embodiment of the Enlightenment ideals. Now, what are those? Well, one of the ways you can see what those are is to read our Declaration of Independence. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all are created equal. All are created equal. No more eating in the kitchen. Endowed by their creator with certain unalienable rights, life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. This is the first time that people became individuals, citizens with rights, and Beethoven lived that idea that came through in not only the American Revolution, but as Natasha said, in the French Revolution also. It started out as liberté, égalité, fraternité before Napoleon then declared himself emperor and took the whole thing down the drain. But this is who Beethoven was. He was this kind of a guy, and it shines through in absolutely everything that he ever wrote. By the way, he frequently called his aristocratic patrons, who paid the bills for everything, spoiled children. I'll give you an idea of his attitude that he brought to all of us. Now, how does this assertive attitude manifest itself in his music? Well, let's see. I'll give you something to compare it against. I talked about the Viennese classical style. Let's start out with a symphony written by Mozart. This is number 29, which is also programmed. So you won't be able to hear this. A wonderful symphony. But just listen to this and sort of get the sense of this. Entertainment for the royals. Don't rock the boat. Nice. 1774. This is in your face, folks. I got something to say. And again, this idea of this creativity takes these four little notes, bum, 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 bum. Who in the world doesn't know those notes? And he turns that into an entire symphony. It's just astonishing the way he does it. All right, what does an 18th century piano concerto sound like, especially written one by Haydn, one written by Haydn? Very nice. Nothing wrong with that. Form was very important. In a standard concerto, it always started with the orchestra, the collective, if you will. The orchestra would lay down the whole thing, the first part of the exposition, the themes, and then they would allow the piano to come on stage. Well, now let's let the piano fool around with it. Not with Beethoven. And so, listen to the way he starts this Emperor. How many of you have heard the Emperor? Sure, I mean, it's well known. But so contrast the Emperor, the beginning of the Emperor, with the beginning of the Haydn piano concerto. Starts out with this orchestra with these blast chords. E flat. Oh, wait, this piano, get the hell out of the way. This is my show. who's in charge here. We'll let the orchestra mess around and do the first exposition. Now, he wrote all of these for himself. He was a virtuoso at the time. Nobody could play any better than Beethoven. He wrote all these for himself. So just in your mind's eye, here's Beethoven storming out to the stage to put this on, putting the orchestra, the collective, in its place. All are created equal. I don't even know Kitchen. This is my show. Also, he's foreshadowing, I don't want to get too far into this, foreshadowing a lot of the stuff we see later on. So you can see precisely what was going on. Now, as I said, his ability to improvise. I talked about piano duels. This will give you a sense of these piano duels. They must have really been something. Here's a contemporary account. On the street, sometime around 1793, the father of pianist Carl Czerny, who was a big star, ran into Joseph Jelinek, a leading virtuoso of the city, dressed up and headed for a piano duel at a reception. Jelinek's opponent was a young foreigner. "I'll fix him," he said to Czerny. The next day, Czerny ran into Jelinek again and asked how the duel went. Jelinek's response was awestruck. "Yesterday was a day I'll remember. That young fellow must be in league with the devil. I've never heard anybody play like that. I gave him a theme to improvise on, and I assure you, I've never heard Mozart improvise so admirably. Then he played some of his own compositions, which are marvelous, really wonderful, and he managed difficulties and effects on the keyboard we never even dreamed of." "I say," said Czerny, "what was his name?" "He's a small, ugly, swarthy fellow, and seems to have a willful disposition. His name is Beethoven." There's another story that's in here about another famous guy named Stiebel at the time. And Beethoven showed up at a Stiebel concert. It was piano and some other instruments. And Stiebel did his thing, and then the audience started to get on. Remember, this is dueling was great. It was a big thing back then. So the audience started getting on Beethoven in the eyes. "Come on, Beethoven, get up and show him what you can do." Well, Beethoven always hung back. Make me. Come on, get up and play. So the story is Beethoven sort of gets up and he slouches over and he picks up the music off of the music stand, the cello part, and he walks over to the piano and he turns the cello part upside down, puts it on the piano, and then starts to plunk out a few notes based on what he's looking at. Well, what happened was quite amazing. On his way to the piano, he picked up the cello part. Slumping down at the keyboard, he made a show of turning it upside down. With one finger, he plunked out a few upside down notes at random. With those notes as a theme, he began to improvise. What followed was breathtaking. Stiebel got the point. When a fiery Beethoven was finished, Stiebel had vanished from the hall. In the future, Stiebel would demand that anyone who desired his presence must promise not to invite Beethoven. an attitude. This piece, this is my conception of it. I don't know whether it makes any sense to you. This piece, to me, starts out as a duel in the first movement between the orchestra and the piano. It's almost an improvisorial duel. The piano sets down these themes and then says, "Okay, piano, what do you got?" And so then we get into the piano thing, and you have this back and forth, almost like a competition between the orchestra and the piano. It's absolutely amazing. The orchestra throws in these themes, and then he takes off and just does marvelous things with him. Miracles. And by the third movement, the orchestra and the piano join forces as equals in this remarkable dance. Now we're all together in this great dance. But in the first movement, there's a lot of back and forth challenging each other. Now again, as I said, the idea of a story is very important. Before Beethoven, each movement of a four-movement symphony was a separate piece. They weren't really connected musically to each other, melodically, rhythmically, thematically. They were just four. It was like four short stories. Beethoven comes along and he turns those four movements or the three in a concerto into a novel. It's one big written through story from start to finish, which gave it a tremendously different feel. And if you listen to a Haydn piece, then you listen to a Beethoven piece, we begin to sense that. that this is something that he's telling us thematically, rhythmically. He writes through to make sure that we can go along with him. And then, of course, the reason why they call this his heroic period between about 1802 and 1809, when the Emperor Piano Concerto was, that's right after this Heiligenstadt test. And this is a guy, you know, he's challenging everything. He's facing the world. That's why they call it his heroic period. So you can follow along with that. Now, as I said before, how does he do this? You know, what's this all about, this creativity, this taking small ideas and turning them into big soundscapes? He can take nothing, if I can mix my metaphor, and turn it into a Mona Lisa. It's like an artist with a palette of alizarin crimson and titanium white and cadmium red, all that stuff. And the next thing you know, it's this amazing picture. He does that with these little teeny ideas. And I kind of like to try to illustrate some of that. I hope this works. I don't know whether it does, but we'll soon find out. You heard the intro. Let's see where we are in the music. I'm going to play for you the first theme. After this lengthy introduction, when he says, okay, it's your turn, orchestra, he plays the first theme. It's pretty simple. Little turnaround. Now the first theme, it sounds pretty simple, pretty innocuous, but it's made up of three parts. The first part is that little turnaround, bum, ba-da-dum, bum, bum. That's the first part. The second part is just bum, 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 descending four notes. The third part is a fanfare, bum, ba, bum. And that's one of the reasons why people thought of this as the emperor. A fanfare is supposed to announce somebody important or something very important. So this bum, ba, bum. There's one old story, it's probably not true, but it's a good story. Never let the facts mess up a good story. That a soldier, when he heard this bum, 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 he jumped up and said, it's the emperor! Who knows? But as I said, it's a good story. So I'm gonna break this down for you. Why? Because Beethoven wants you to hear and get these three motives, as he called them in the first theme, in your ear. Because for the rest of the first movement, then he's playing with these various motives. Back then, people were pretty sophisticated about this, and they could follow this stuff, and he wanted us to see, get these motives. He's taking apart this atom, and now he's going to show us what it's all about. Let me see if I can access the first motive. That's the first motive. Bump, ba-da-dum, bump, bump. That turn comes back a million times. But he's a genius in bringing it back in so many different ways that it never gets boring or repetitive. So that's the first one, bum, ba-da-dum, bum, bum. And then it's linked to the second motive. The last motive of the first motive is linked to the next one. It goes like this, just this descending four notes. Bum, 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 bum. That ties together. And then there's the fanfare motive, which is linked to the second one. Now, how do we know that he wants us to hear these things? Because after he lays these out in a kind of a very sort of a simple way, and we're starting to get them in our ear, then he takes a highlighter or a spotlight and puts the highlighter first on the turnaround, bump, ba-da-dum, bump, bump. Then he puts the highlighter or the spotlight on the second one, thump, 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 thump. And then he puts the spotlight on the third one, bump, ba-bum. And, you know, back then, you were hearing these things for the first time. You couldn't go home and put on a CD or a record or something like that. So the part of the idea of an exposition is to get it in your ear so you know what this is all about when he starts taking off and going through it. So then I'm going to play the first three parts, and you'll see how he highlights these three motives in the first theme. First, he motivates the turnaround. Highlights. That's highlighted. Second time, listen to what he highlights. four notes is all over this thing. You hear its progeny, you hear its cousins. Sometimes it's going da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. But that's what he does. He starts out with these atoms, as I keep saying, and all of a sudden he's converting them into these remarkable soundscapes. So now after you hear the orchestra go through the theme, there's two main themes in the orchestra's part. Then the orchestra turns to him, it's like this duel, and says, okay, let's see what you got. Well, this is what you get. When the piano does the it's a big flourish. It's me. Motive one, two, and then just off, improvising, just floating. It's gorgeous lyrical stuff. It's very martial when the orchestra has it. And he turns it into something else. And then later on in the exposition, he says, oh, that was pretty simple. Let me show you what I got. You want virtuosity? Listen, the crossroads are crazy. That's nice. It's not too memorable, but here it is. Here's the second theme in the exposition. Orchestra. Same thing, flourish. It's me again, folks. But he turns this into a moment that to me is one of the magic moments of all music. I'm just captivated by what he does with the second theme. It's phenomenal. Here it is. Like a music box. Stuff too. And he sort of calms down a little bit. Now there's a part in here that I call it the challenge. The orchestra and the piano are calling each other out with the fanfare mode. It's almost like, let's brawl, let's do something here. What do I mean by a competition? And you can hear this fanfare motive, and they keep throwing it back and forth at each other. Recapitulation, the whole idea is reconciliation, getting back together. It's like a story, you know, you meet the characters, then there's all this drama, and then everybody gets back together and there's a nice sunset. So in the recapitulation at the end, the orchestra and the pianist get back together, and they start playing these wonderful things together, and this is what it sounds like. Tender music. Wait till you hear this. There's all kinds of fun things in here, but we don't have time to go into them. But it's in a key that's so far remote from E flat, it's like going from San Diego to Kathmandu. You're off in a completely different key. Now, you know, I can't tell you what key it's in when I listen to it, but you know you're someplace else. Now, he's got to get back to E flat, because that's the way these things work. You have to get back to home. You start in Kansas, you go to Oz, you have to go back to Kansas. Now, he's off in this crazy key. How the hell is he going to get back to E flat? Well, there's a moment that I missed. Everybody misses it because it seems to be insignificant. But when he wrote this in 1809, and people listened to this, they were like, what was that? Because he breaks all the rules right on the spot, breaks all the rules, just crushes them when he moves from the third movement, which is written right through without a pause, from the second movement, right without a pause, right through the third movement. And this is one of the reasons why he got a lot of bad critiques when he was writing music, because he broke all the rules. And when he did stuff like this, people would write critiques like, well, my favorite one is, Beethoven writes terrible music with occasional lucid intervals displaying bad taste. That's what they would write. And so here's this movement where you go from the second to the third. It starts out in B and then it pivots down to B flat. It just goes, it's like the elevator goes down a floor. And that happens to be a key. It's the dominant of E flat, so it pivots back into the third movement. But let me play this for you so you can hear this movement. It's coming. It comes on a single pitch, B. Drove people nuts back then. And now it goes right through and you can hear him improvising. What do we have to do for the third movement? Now, that's not too bad. Let's try it again. Yeah, I think I got it. We're back in A flat. But he puts all these beats in a different place. The syncopations are just crazy. This is another way he uses rhythm and his creative genius to make all of these things work. I love this. And then he chromatically falls off. Another one of my favorite places is in this movement where all of a sudden this thing comes out of nowhere. And I don't know what it is, but I just absolutely adore this thing. But at the end of it, he does something really crazy. This is where I think I hear a lot of the humor that you hear in Beethoven. He's cooking along and all of a sudden he gets into this wild piece. He's driving. But listen to how he comes out of this. He almost gets lost. It's like he's falling off a cliff. And the orchestra has to prompt him where you are and get him back on line. I just love this moment. Let's see if you can hear it. Listen for the orchestra. Harmonic modulations in this piece or in all of his pieces. But the one thing that he does that makes it so interesting is that everything he does seems to be, well, that's just, that had to happen. I mean, it's all there. It's so human in a kind of a sense. But he leads you down, as Eric said, one path after another, and then pulls the rug out from underneath you. You know, you're waiting for him to get to the tonic chord, and he does something crazy, he's off someplace else. Or all of a sudden these rhythms where he's emphasizing two instead of one, two, three, or something like that. So you're always on, I'm always on the edge of my seat when I listen to Beethoven. He's one of the few composers that I can listen to for hours, and my mind never wanders. Why? Because he's got me. He's taken me on this incredible trip as I listen to this music. So as you can tell, I don't like the emperor. And I'm so delighted that Natasha's here to play it for us, and I think you're going to enjoy this concert. Mozart, Beethoven, and Schubert. Holy cow, talk about murderer's row. So we have 2 minutes. Anybody have any questions? Mark?
Was he composing all this while he was deaf?
Oh, yeah, he composed right up to the Ninth Symphony. He couldn't hear a damn thing. He had to. He could not premiere the Fifth Piano Concerto because he could no longer hear well enough to play with an orchestra.
Wow.
So Czerny actually premiered it in 1811. But I mean, the creative output on December 22nd, 1808, he premiered the Fifth Symphony, the Sixth Symphony, and he played his Fourth Piano Concerto, plus a whole lot of other stuff. I mean, it's like a spike in creativity. Boom! And he literally took the 18th century and ripped it, tore off all the chains right into the Romantic period in the 19th century. You remember when we talked about Brahms? He's so scared of Brahms. Brahms didn't write a symphony until he was 43 years old. Then they called it Beethoven's 10th.
Beethoven ever have a nervous breakdown?
No.
And there's the letter.
Well, there's the highly.
I
want to
die.
You ought to read this letter, highly enchanted testament. It's in every book I've ever seen by Beethoven. And it'll kill you when you listen to this and you sort of identify with what he couldn't even stand being among people anymore. Because my father was deaf, and when you're talking to somebody and somebody else is talking, you don't hear, you just want to get the hell out of the room, is what my father told me. It drives you crazy not to be able to hear people. So, no, he walked right up to that line and he came out of it with his Third Symphony. Boom! Starting with another thing, just with it. Takes that E-flat chord, again, that heroic chord, just unpacks it right on the spot. So, no, I don't think he was depressed. Tony?
Where does the Fifth Piano Concerto fall chronologically?
Well, it's 809, so it's right after the Fifth and the Sixth, before the Seventh. Am I right?
Right.
Yeah, right there. But they call that the end of his heroic period. You know, when you study music, they say, well, there's Renaissance in the 15th century, and then you go to Baroque, 16th until 1750, when Bach died, and then you go to Viennese Classical, 1750 until 1800, and then they say, and then Beethoven. And then you go to Romantic and Modern. I mean, they carve out a whole chunk, and they just say, this is Beethoven.
Steve, I admire your love for Beethoven so much, so I have to throw this curveball at you.
Throw it.
Because you say you can listen to Beethoven for hours without your mind wandering.
Right.
How do you feel about Wellington's victory?
Okay.
It's the elephant in the room anytime we speak of Beethoven.
Beethoven got really, I call it, sucked in the writing a piece. Celebrating Wellington's great victory over Napoleon. Napoleon invaded and tried to crush Austria so many times you can't even believe it. I mean, when Beethoven was writing this piano concerto, he was down in the basement with bombs going off, holding things over his ears, trying to protect the hearing that he had left. And so, they were there. And when Wellington knocked off Beethoven, they went on a huge celebration. He wrote this piece, Wellington's Victory. And at the time, it was probably the most popular of Beethoven's pieces. People loved it. You won't hear anybody program it today because it ain't wonderful. that was something that he did more for, not for himself, but for other things. But you're right about Wellington's victory. Google it up, and it starts out, it's crash bang.
It is entertaining,
yes.
Nothing else.
Anybody else? Thank you so much for coming. You're just going to love this.